You're tuning in to the Black Hollywood Live Network, featuring news, interviews, and commentary on all things Black Hollywood. Hollywood redefined. From Los Angeles, California, streaming live thanks to Akamai Technologies, this is Black Hollywood Live. Next, featuring intimate and in-depth interviews with Black Hollywood's next edition of stars and influencers. Black Hollywood Live. Hollywood redefined.
You're listening to Black Hollywood Live.
And now, the host for Black Hollywood Live, next.
Yeah, it's another episode of Black Hollywood Live. Next, we are here in studio. You know how we do every single week. We have an amazing, amazing guest in Hollywood. We're going to have an amazing guest this week. It's no different. I'm one of your hosts, Megan Thomas, at Meg Scoop on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, and Periscope.
And I'm your co-host, James Ward III. You can find me at James Ward III across all platforms.
Yes. And this guy is amazing. You've seen him on OWN on the Haves and Have Nots. He's handsome. He's really, really talented. Give it up for the one and only Gavin Houston.
Yeah, thank you. Wow, what an introduction.
Yeah, because you're worthy of that.
Well, thank you. I appreciate it.
This is your
intro music. This is my theme song.
This is what you walk.
You got to come
walking out to the ring right now.
Well, before we get started with all about you, we're going to talk about some things going on in the world. Let's talk about what's going on in casting. Usually we talk about what's going on in casting with a movie or a film, but now we're going to talk about what's going on in casting at the SAG Awards. SAG So Black. That is the hashtag that was used in opposition of Oscar So White. Because at the SAG Awards, we made history, y'all. We made history. Idris Elba won 2 awards. Queen Latifah, Viola Davis, Uzo Aduba all won awards as well, which is the most that has ever happened at the SAG Awards. And if you look it up, it's actually more melanin on that stage than has ever been on the Oscar stage since 2007.
But you know,
put that out there.
But with that, Megan, I think one of the reasons being is that the Academy, as we mentioned in, I think maybe a week or so ago, is represented by primarily older white men. But the SAG Awards, what makes it so unique is it's actors voting for actors.
Right.
So it's more representative of what the industry really is.
Right. Is that, what about, so Gavin, for you, I mean, you're an actor. This directly affects you as a black man in America. You're an actor. How do you feel about this whole controversy, especially with the fact that you have Oscar So White, now there's SAG So Black? Like, how does that make you feel as a black man?
I mean, it just shows that, you know, there needs to be some changes made. You know, it needs to be almost like an even playing field.
Right.
And like you just stated, in terms of the actors, when they can vote, they'll just vote for the best performance, and it'll be colorless. There won't be suede. It won't have any of that.
Right.
So I think you walk outside, there's diversity everywhere.
Yeah.
So why wouldn't we have that in a panel of judges? You know, if we can really judge art. But at least, you know, different people will affect them differently. You know, different cultures and types of people are represented.
What do you think about, because I'm torn with this when, you know, you've got Janet Huber telling people don't go to the Oscars because they didn't put any of us on the list. Like, what are your thoughts on that? Because I'm torn.
So, I don't agree with doing it like that.
Right.
Meaning dictating to other people what they should do.
Right.
Because of your opinion of something. There are different ways of sharing your opinion to bring attention to an issue without telling people what they need to do to make it. If that's something you want to do, then that's fine.
Right.
I think every person has their own right to make their own, you know, opinion of how they want to treat it. But absolutely, there should be light shed on this, you know? But I don't know about telling people not to.
And telling people, telling Chris Rock, you better not get on that stage. I'm like, wait, you don't take the one black spot we got at the Oscars? We need that black spot. That?
You know, and what's that going to do? What's that going to prove?
Right.
You know?
But, you know, I am curious to see if he actually changed his script.
Oh, I'm sure he did.
Wait, what did he say?
He rewrote his entire, all of his jokes, everything, once this whole Oscar So White thing happened. He was like, okay, so now basically he's probably going to be roasting the Oscars, roasting all of the, you know, the everyone who voted and say, hey, I'm making fun of you guys.
Now, I have a question for the two of you.
Yeah, sure. Go ahead.
Why do you think this is happening now? You know, of all the Oscar ceremonies, of all the nominees that there have been, you know, of color and winners of color, like, why now is all this attention brought onto it?
Right.
do you feel?
I mean, I think it's because the whole, I think racial tensions are just high in this country. Black mm-hmm. Lives Matter. We've had a lot, you know, in 2015, that was huge. Mm-hmm. You know, it. Everybody, everywhere you went, there's somebody talking about mm-hmm. it, whether they were black or not. So I mm-hmm. think that's just in the forefront of people's mind. They're like, now it happens again in the Oscars. You know, now we don't have the hashtag, the thing that's going on with, you know, outside of Hollywood. Now it's affecting Hollywood as well. It's always affected Hollywood, but it's now that there's a spotlight on it.
Which is great.
And I also think that actually, in terms of the progression of the industry, the Academy is the one entity that is actually kind of behind. Mm. The TV Academy is eons beyond the Film Academy.
Yeah,
you know what I mean?
That's true, yeah.
And the SAG Awards. So I think it's now just kind of that spotlight is happening because the times are changing and they're not keeping up.
Yeah. Why do you think it is?
I agree with both of the things that you both said. It's just, it's time. Right. And so many things, the world is changing around us and you have to move with the change of the times. So it's just time to get with it. And it's just time to make it just about the art, and the only way you can make it about the art is just to have an even, you know, equal playing field of people who are judging it.
Right. And you are on an amazing TV station that does that as well. Shout out to Oprah for giving us some opportunities.
Mama,
yes.
And giving us some employment. Thank you. Shout out to Oprah and Tyler.
Well, let's talk about what's hot in music. What's the Fresh Beatz looking like this week?
Fresh Beatz this week is coming from British singer Zayn, who auditioned for the British reality TV competition, The X Factor. Uh-huh. After being eliminated as a solo artist, he was brought back with four other members to form a group that we know, One Direction.
One Direction.
Yeah.
Well, let's listen to that song.
Climb on board. We'll go slow and high tempo. Lighting up. Hold me hard and mellow. I'm seeing the pain, seeing the pleasure. Nobody but you, body but me, body but us, bodies together. I love to hold you close tonight and always.
So in March 2015, he announced his career as a solo artist. And his debut solo studio album entitled Mind of Mine is slated to release on March 25th of this year, preceded by this single that he just dropped.
I just want to say this, though. I'm looking at this video here. Look, explicit. Zayn, whoa. Your One Direction fans can't watch this.
It's artistic.
Well, you know, there's actually, to that note, I read something, too, about, you know, he's Muslim.
Yeah.
And so some people in the Muslim community have voiced their disapproval of this type of imagery not representing, you know, their culture correctly.
What do you think about this music, Gavin? I think it sounds like Drake. Like, it sounds very, like, I feel like it's the same producer, or they're using the same kind of
I like the song, but I feel like it feels like, I almost think, like, if I just listen to the song, I don't see the artist.
Right.
Like, I feel like there are, like, three different artists I could say, that could be them.
Exactly, that's what I was thinking of, too.
The tone, the pacing, the sound.
It's easily a beepster. It's easily a throwback to New Kids on the Block.
Absolutely.
I could even see Usher doing it. It's quite
absolutely. It's very Usher.
I think it's a Chris Brown also.
Chris Brown.
Like, is that you, Chris? I don't know. The music all is starting to sound the same to me. I'm just waiting for that, you know, 90s R&B to come back.
Oh, my gosh. How good was the music
Sweet
in the
90s?
It was.
I think it was the best.
I know, SWV, come back hard, please. Total, where are you? All right, and what's going on with the next big thing, the tech stuff?
Tech stuff. So there's this flashlight called the X800.
Okay.
Now, most people, you know, we all have flashlights, right?
Right.
So there's this one that's actually now, they've sold 20,000 units.
Okay.
This
Wait,
month
what's
alone.
What's so special about the flashlight?
So this, it's called the Shadowhawk X800, and it's a new military-grade tactical flashlight that's on sale to the general public. So this flashlight's LED technology is used by the U.S. Navy, the Coast Guard.
So if you drop it, the batteries won't fall out.
Right.
Okay. Right.
Firemen, policemen, U.S. search and rescue. So it's a really, you know, intense light.
Oh, it's like a spotlight. So
exactly.
When they, like, oh,
so you guys can see the pictures up there.
Oh, my gosh.
It's quite intense.
Wow.
And it's like a really small one, too, right? It's
mm-hmm.
like it's the size of a pin or something. It's like that long.
And there's people who have been tweeting and have already been using it.
That's dangerous. You shouldn't give that to the general public.
You shouldn't. And they're on sale for $200. However, there are online sites you can find right now that are selling them up to 75% off.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, their biggest tagline about it is that it's promoting personal safety in case there's a natural disaster or a potential attacker. It can blind you for longer than like 3 minutes.
That's okay. So somebody's gonna get a car accident because some kids are be like, ha ha, blind
no,
you.
It's about the size of like
it's like little.
Little. There it is.
Oh,
right,
like
there.
That.
Yeah.
Like it'll fit in your palm of your hand.
You know, I have one of those like that in my car.
Right. But it's not gonna blind somebody in oncoming traffic.
You know, like when you know, someone takes a flash and it's like you gotta blink for a little bit. Right. This will last for like up to 3 minutes if
this
the flash
is so
denies.
Dangerous.
Yeah, if it's in your eyes, dead in your eyes.
Why
yeah.
do you need that? So dangerous.
Yeah. Apparently they fear that people need.
Okay, well, don't nobody flash that in my eye, please.
Please.
Please don't. All right. Let's talk about you, Gavin.
Yes.
You are such an interesting guy. What made you want to be an actor, and did you always know you wanted to be an actor?
No, I didn't. I was always, like, a performer and just never shy and just bold, and I always enjoyed entertaining people when I was little. And my sister was a model, and we were friends with Keisha Knight Pulliam's mom, and we knew of her manager, who was in town. So my dad was bringing my sister, and then they just brought me along. And they saw me, and they gave me something to read. And I was like, okay, I could do this. So I read it, and they wanted to work with me and not my sister.
Oh, ooh. Was she mad? Yeah.
For a little bit. For a little bit. Yes, for a little bit. But then I just fell in love with it, just being able to affect people, to communicate my artistry, to just have that ability to perform. And I was doing a lot of theater, so just feeling that energy, that live energy, because all acting is born in the theater, you know. And that's
that
really
exchange.
It's just honest. Things happen, mistakes happen, and it's just real, and you know, it's live.
What was the first TV show or film that you did that you were like, oh my god?
The Cosby Show.
Right. Yeah. So when you watched yourself, was it like, we're going to have a viewing party at the house?
No.
Like,
you kidding me? I was so scared.
How old were you on then?
I was 11.
Oh, wow.
And I didn't like the attention of it, you know, in terms of like people were making a big deal of it, especially in school. And I was getting teased. Mm-hmm. So I didn't like it because I've never been one to like a lot of attention. But, you know, certain things, doing something like being an actor, you're going to have a lot of eyes on you. So it made me nervous. But it was such a great experience. I remember I got to dance with Felicia Rashad. And I was just nervous because at that point, it was like the biggest show on TV.
It was,
So, and then after that, I was like, yeah, I want to do this. I want to do this. And then I left it in college. And then I remember I did a play. I started to like crash the auditions because I was like, oh, I want to act again. And I wasn't in the theater department, so I started crashing a lot of those auditions, and then I got into the department, started doing plays. I invited my dad again to a play, and he thought he was going to be in the crowd with me. Not that he didn't think I was going to be on stage. He saw me on stage, and then he gave me his blessing, and then I was like, okay, I'm just going to be doing this, and that's it.
That's good.
Yep, so that's my story.
Did you ever have, like, a weird job, like, to support your passion?
I was a... to support my passions. This is after college. I remember I used to make. I had a job where I was making balloons, like balloons
like
into like dogs.
Twist them and
you twist them.
Wait,
yeah.
You can make like balloon animals?
No, I can't do that. It popped. it popped so many times, and it was like scared the kids a lot. You know, I was doing it at parties, and I was just like, and then you know, I'd make dogs, I'd make dinosaurs, I'd make all kinds of things. But hey, it was 50-50, like half of them would pop, half of them, and I would just figure out new ways, like, oh, okay.
So you were that balloon guy that would come to a kid's party and they would get mad because you...
Yeah, because
so
I wasn't that good at making the balloons.
Well, good thing you got fired.
So yeah, it was good that I got fired, yeah.
Good job.
So do you prefer TV versus, you know, film versus theater, or what's really your route with that?
Prefer theater. Oh, I think I'll always prefer theater. Because, you know, there's times with TV and, you know, film, like, we got to get the shot, so we need you to look here, and this person's going to look, and so it's, like, recreated.
Mechanical.
Uh-huh. Yeah, a little bit. Theater just has a natural flow. Like, it's going from start to finish, and we're going to get there, and we're going to have this journey, and there's been times things have been set wrong. There was one time to do a Shakespeare play, I couldn't get my sword out to tell my army to go into battle. So you just have to, like, adjust, you know, and it's just alive, and then there's also just the energy of the audience, like right then and there. And sometimes things you think that would be funny, they don't laugh at, and you wait for it, and they're like, okay, that's not funny. And then something happens, and now they start laughing. So it's just like, it's just in the moment, and it's just live, and I think it's better than. But the one thing I will say about film and TV is seeing it, once it's all been edited, like, the, they put the score over it and this and that, like, I just did the Tony Braxton movie where I played Babyface. Right. And like I was like, wow, I can sing on this, because I had to sing in real life because they need to see what's
perfect
happening.
Casting, by the way. I have to say that's it's
you look exactly like him.
Well, you know, I used to get teased about that growing up. So it was like, as soon as I got it, I was like, all right, I'm putting it on Facebook. So everybody from high school and junior high, like after I do this, it is over. It is done.
They spoke it into existence.
They did speak it into existence, and it was an honor to play it. And I was out of the final few I was selected actually by him. Mm-hmm. So I just I really really like focused on everything about him. And but we had a lot of rehearsals. We had a lot of choreography. And but hearing his voice over my performance singing, it was like, wow.
Now I'm like, man, I can sing.
I can sing. You know, I know I can't, but it's just like nice to like, it really looks like I can sing. I was like, that sounds good. So that was cool.
What was it like talking with him, you know, because you have to play somebody in real life that is living versus, you know, playing somebody on the haves and have not, who is a fictional character?
Well, I never got to actually meet him. But I felt like there's a lot of things that are just similar. Mm-hmm. Like there's like I'm kind of more soft spoken in a lot of ways and just really about the art and just really like we had almost it's funny because we had a when we had our table read, Toni Braxton was there and she would just look, she was like, gosh, it's so much like Kenny. Like you're so much like him. So I think just having certain things, finding the similarities and being able to like raise those, and then finding little things like, you know, just and asking lots of questions. Like I asked a lot of questions, but it was really cool, and it was a huge responsibility because you know, if you don't do it right. You're gonna hear about it,
right?
And they will let you know because there are too many fans for you to mess it up,
right?
So, but it was well received, and you know, so I'm glad everybody was really happy about it.
That's good. Awesome. That's good. That's good. So you moved from LA you moved from New York City area, Jersey. That's where you're from.
Jersey.
You moved from that area doing Broadway. You came out here to LA to do TV and film. What was that transition like? Because that's pretty tough.
It was hard. I missed home. So many people told me don't do it, you know, but for me, I've always been like, more people say, don't do that, or you can't do this, or it won't work out more. I'm like, I'm doing it. You know, I can't. That's the best motivational speech I've ever gotten is when the people who said what I couldn't do. Mm-hmm. So it was tough. It was tough initially because you miss the comfort of it. Mm-hmm. But sometimes comfort can be the most dangerous thing to have, you know, because it can prevent you from growing or continuing to take risks. Mm-hmm. So that initially was bad, but you know what? I had some nice weather and some palm trees and some beaches, and so I was able to get past it. And I was like, you know what?
Even on a bad day, you're like, you know?
No snow.
This is not too bad. You know?
No snow.
All these places I get all these green juices and people jogging and dogs and this is so it was a little bit different, but it was cool. I'm so thankful that I did it.
Mm-hmm. And then you're soap operas, okay? So all these old ladies in middle America know your face.
Guiding Light, General Hospital.
Started on.
So what was that like to be on such iconic soap operas?
It was interesting because it was a little bit intimidating because so many of those soap operas have the same people that people have grown to love. And so you're kind of like the new fish, the new guy on the block, and there are these staple people. So, you know, it was a little bit intimidating, and I always wanted to add a different flair to it. So, you know, with those roles. But I will say this, it's like boot camp, and I think it was the best preparation to be on the haves and the have-nots now, because we move pretty quickly, but that's because, you know, Tyler trusts that we can do it. Mm-hmm. But it's a similar style. The amount of material that we have to do and the depth and the drama and how deep it goes, I just feel like that was the best training, those initial soaps, you know, to have it.
So speaking of Tyler Perry, so you played Jeffrey Harrington, right?
I played Jeffrey Harrington.
Yes, you played Jeffrey, who, by the way, I was watching the clip of when you guys, you and Tika Sumter are there, and you killed Quincy. That's the name, right?
Oh, we killed Quincy.
And you're like,
we killed
the man. There's blood on me. I was like, oh, this is good drama. I'm like, you did good, Popcorn. Gavin.
Oh, thank you.
I know. I need popcorn for this. So, of course, you play Jeffrey Harrington, and you get to work with Tyler Perry.
Yeah.
What is that like? We've had a lot of people who are on different shows come in here and talk about working with Tyler. They love it, but they're just like, it's intense. So what is that like working with him?
Well, I think, you know, they always say part of the director's hardest, the hardest part of his job happens during the casting. Mm-hmm. So I think that's where the work happens, to know that you're going to cast the right people.
Right.
And then after that, so you come in already with certain expectations, because he knows that he's casted you for a reason. So you come in and he's going to work you, you know? But through it all, it's collaborative, and he's there, and he's also an actor, so he knows how to get you to the places that he needs you to get to. He's very patient with us. So I really appreciate that, and he just really makes sure that the actor is always knowing what's going on, very comfortable with it, and regardless of what's happening around or the pacing that we're taking. So I think it's great. I think it's great because he's just normal. He's just like anybody else. So it's just like, it's just fun, you know? So
yeah. And how, like, when you found out you got the role, what was that like for you?
Oh, when I found out I got the role, I remember I literally almost dropped to my knees, because I was working on something else at the time, and I had to fly out that. I think it was early the next morning. And I knew I was gonna have time to change, so I was in my suit, and it was getting all, I wore a shirt and tie, and I think it was getting all wrinkled. I'm like, oh man, and I was exhausted because I was still working. But I went, and initially the character was gonna be a counselor, and I got there late, and they had to put me in a room, because there's some other people screen testing. They put me in a room with a girl who was going for auditioning for Candace's role. And so because I was late, I just had to take her room. I didn't get my own like everybody else. And she had a nervous breakdown in it.
Oh my gosh.
So I started to calm her, started to just what a counselor would do. And she was like, okay. She was so thankful. She was like, well, let's go over your scene a little bit. And I was like, okay. And I felt confident, but I was like, okay, if you want to do it. So I went over the scene with her. And she said, I have an idea about something, just about that opening part. I think it would be almost nice to do this. And I was like, oh, well, all right. I didn't really think about it, just to start the scene. And so I auditioned, and I was so nervous. And then I got brought back in to read alongside Angela Robinson, who plays Veronica, who plays my mom on the show.
Right.
And I was so nervous. And I had the first line, couldn't remember it at all.
Oh, wow.
So I'm like, and it was so quiet. And I know Tyler's watching, all the producers. But I remembered what she suggested. And it was just laughter. And I did that. And immediately I felt comfortable. And I got into my first line. And it came to me. So almost being there for her helped, you know, kind of, was a blessing in disguise, because she put something on it, and it just, and I was just like, I didn't know what else to do, but I remembered that. So I did that, and all of a sudden everything just came to me, because I just laughing and smiling got me to calm down.
That's awesome. See, because I know you're probably in there like, I do not have time.
I was like,
calming this girl down.
I know. Get it together. I was like, now you put me in this room with this. Right. I just got off the plane. I'm trying to relax and get, and so yeah.
Better count your blessings. That is awesome. Awesome. So then, of course, you know, you've been in a lot of different TV shows. You've done a lot of different projects. So far, what has been your most favorite?
This one, the haves and the have-nots. Just because of what I've learned, the growth that's happened, what's been asked of me as well. Just playing a character that's challenging, that's so opposite from me.
Right.
Just also playing a character that has affected so many people and has had such a great positive response, and so many people are kind of living vicariously because they can compare it to their own life experiences, whether with their sexuality, with their parents, with their, you know. Because I play Jeffrey Harrington, who's a gay character. So just how he had to come out to his family, I mean, all that stuff is just huge, you know. So many people have lived that.
Right.
So this one has just taught me so much, and I've had to just learn so much, and I've been given so much. So it's been a huge opportunity, a huge challenge, and a huge blessing in the
end. Right. And so then, you know, you've been, so you talked about this role, you've been many crazy guys on the different soap operas. Mm-hmm. So then in the future, what would you like to play? What would be your ideal role?
I've always wanted to play a cop or a detective. My dad was in forensics, and I never forget.
Wow.
He gave like a speech at one of my like junior high school, and I didn't know what he was had set up, but I guess I got some of my performing from him. He, when everybody sat down, he ran in this crazy looking outfit, grabbed something like a thief, and then ran out the other door. And then he came down as himself, like in a suit, and then said, you know, something just happened, like, you know, what are the clues that we can find from this? And he actually ran through like a dirt pile that he left, so we had his footprints, then we had, you know, fingerprints from what he touched.
Oh, wow.
So I always thought being a detective and just putting together the pieces and the puzzles, and I watched like the first 48, I watched a lot of other like detective shows, Law and Orders, I love all of them. So I think if I could play some sort of a cop, I would love to do that and just be in some sort of like action and gunfire and all that. I love that stuff. And a lot of stunts. I love that.
You know, it's going to happen. Scenes. Because I thought you had played a cop before.
I've never played a cop. I played a bad guy, and I've had to do fight scenes, and I have a martial arts background.
Right.
And a gymnast. I used to be a gymnast. So action and action is and drama is what I would love to do.
So speaking of gymnastics and martial arts, how did you even get involved with that?
My sister started gymnastics
again.
Yo, you owe your life to your sister.
I'm stealing. I do.
She probably is still mad at you.
She got into gymnastics first. She got into it first, and then they just brought me along again. And I was like, wow, this is really good. And then she, like, the attention went to me, and then I started competing. And this was in the 80s. So I did stuff with like some of the Olympians, like Mary Lou Retton, Bart Connor, Mitch Gaylord, and at one point, I think when I was 11 or 12, I was ranked number 2 in the state and like 7 in the region in terms of my class.
Oh,
so
wow.
I got deep into it, and you never forget that stuff. I can still do handstand push-ups, splits, standing back tucks.
What?
So yeah, yeah. So
I wish we had the space here.
Yeah, the space. So I can
prove it,
and break my neck in these shoes. No, so I would love to. I love like martial arts and being able to use that and like and play a cop and blow stuff up like Bad Boys 5. I'm ready for it.
Right.
You know. So yeah, that would be awesome.
I think you're the first male gymnast I've ever met. I was just thinking about that.
Fitness is a huge part of me, and I'm also a vegetarian. So I've been vegetarian for about like 8 years now.
Like what kind of vegetarian? Because you know there's different types.
Oh, I know. I almost was going to say vegan, but I'm not 100% vegan.
Okay.
Because I do eat egg whites.
Okay.
So
okay.
That's where I eat a ton of egg whites. So where someone would have meat, I'm eating egg whites. So I have
your protein.
Like,
yeah.
Yeah. I have a huge pot that cooks like 6 to 7 dozen sometimes.
Really?
Oh my gosh. Yep. And I eat 6 to 7 per meal.
So here's the thing, because I used to be pesca vegan.
Pesca vegan.
It's a thing.
That's the first time I've heard that.
I thought I like created that, but apparently it's already a thing. There's like a website.
You might have created
it. I didn't. I thought I was doing something genius, but no, I was vegan, but I ate fish.
Right.
So that was
it. Got it.
But now I'm trying to decide what I want to be. I don't know. I don't know where the line it should be drawn. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Like, I don't know if I should just be vegetarian. What kind of vegetarian? Is it a pescatarian?
Well, I always, and I studied nutrition. I went into college like a pre-med, so I studied a lot of nutrition. And I always think it's best for people to find themselves and find what works for them. I can't stand when vegetarians are pushing things on people or telling them what they need to do. I think, if anything, you present what works for you so they have the information
they
and then encourage people to do their own research and use their own body to experiment with and see what makes your body feel energized and feel like your mood feel good. So you have to literally just experiment and investigate it on your own and then do your own research.
And listen to your body.
You know, and I think that's the best thing. And you know, seeing what you feel, doing your research, trying certain things. That's what I did. And then I was like, because I've been on both sides of it. So I was like, this is what works for me. You know,
What made you say, okay, I'm going to stop eating meat?
I knew the health benefits. Uh-huh. If I cut it down, I knew the health benefits. I saw a movie called Earthlings. I saw it once, and I stopped everything but chicken. I saw it again. Done. I was done.
That chicken, we had a hype.
That chicken, I'm holding on to you, chicken. You're not going anywhere. I saw it again. I was like, all right, fine, chicken. And so then, you know, when I saw it again, I was like, okay, but I'm going to do this intelligently. I'm going to make sure that I get the protein is a huge thing.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And so I also found out that the cleanest protein was egg whites, meaning your body uses the net utilization of egg whites is 90-something% versus meat, where it's like 70-something. Ah. What it actually uses versus what it'll get rid of through its kidneys. So when I found that it was so high in egg whites and clean, I was like, okay, I just need to eat more of this. So I started just eating more of it, and I felt great. Mm-hmm. And I didn't lose, I work out, so I didn't lose any muscular size or anything like that. And I was like, I can do this. So I just made that the new habit.
And then how many years has it been now?
8.
Oh my gosh. Eight. Do you ever like look at something and be like, I almost ate you, chicken.
Chicken smells good. Chicken smells good sometimes. But it's almost like after a while, you're like, man, it smells good.
Yeah.
But you just look at it like, yeah. Like you don't feel anything anymore towards it. So it's just like your body is completely reprogrammed. And literally, it's embarrassing, but sometimes I have a little thing and I bring egg whites with me to restaurants too.
Right.
So sometimes...
That's commitment.
Because the best part is I do it now and I just wait to see what the waiter or the waitress does when they come back. They go, so how is it? Oh. Okay.
Like, yeah,
this, so but I know I can just get some vegetables or I can get some like brown rice or something and I have my protein, bam, complete. You know, and I'm good. So I don't need anything else.
Okay, see, that's good. Because I'm 2 weeks in being vegan. I'm trying to cleanse. I'm getting back on the horse. And that chicken looks mighty.
You know, and I will say this. I will say this. It's usually darkest before the dawn. In the sense that the initial steam, it's kind of like a rocket. That initial boost takes the most energy.
Right.
Because you're going to get the cravings from the physical attachment to food.
Right.
Certain foods, the emotional attachment to certain foods. So just know. Mm-hmm. But then once your body's like, all right, I guess I'm not getting this.
The emotional attachment is key.
Oh, yeah. It is. It is. Yeah. The wind down food. Everybody has their wind down food, like a long day. It's nighttime.
Cupcakes. All that stuff.
Well, they make vegan cupcakes.
They make vegan cupcakes.
They don't taste like a real cupcake. Don't get it twisted. They don't. I tried those. Trust me. Okay, so you're super busy. You've got a lot of things going on. Are you in a relationship?
I have someone special in my life.
Someone special.
Right now.
How do you balance all the things that you have going on and then someone special?
I think... It's funny because there's, in so many ways, there's no one has time. But I think for the things that are important to you, you make time.
Oh, can you say that again? Because there's probably a gentleman out there that needs to hear that.
Oh, just you know, I think you make the time for the things that are important for you. Even if you don't have it, you make it, and it could be with something subtle. Mm-hmm. It could be with just making sure that they are a part of your process or your day or what you're going through, and just incorporating it, or just showing that you're still thinking about them, caring about them, you know. So I think you just find it and you make time. And you know, it's not as always as easy, but I think when people feel appreciated and still feel like the connection, like, okay, they're busy, but
I matter.
Yeah, I matter. You know, and they're taking me with them through the busy. Even if it's just like, hey, just checking in, hope you're having a good day. Because now we have texting, now we have this and that. Like, there's ways. And I think even if it takes 2 minutes, you can make the time.
Oh, you better say that. what are the top three qualities for a significant other for you?
For me? I feel, number one, are they happy? Are they a happy person? Before I come in the mix at all, are they just genuinely happy in their life, in their own skin? Right. And, you know, do they know themselves? That's one. Also, are they, this goes huge for me, having street smarts. You know what I mean? And I mean that in the sense of like common sense and like street smarts. I know there's book smarts and there's street smarts.
Right.
Someone who just has a personality where like something could go down and I can look on the other side of the table and they're looking right back at me like, mm-hmm. They catch things, you know? Right. So just having some street smarts. And then just a healthy lifestyle, a healthy person, and someone who's just open and honest and just like I said, I think just being able to almost, because I never believed in the, like, someone completes you.
Right.
Yeah, no one walks around, I'm incomplete, I hope something can come around and complete me.
Well, people do. Well, and that's where the problem lies.
That's
where
the problem
lies,
yeah. Right. Mm-hmm. But I think as long as they're whole and complete and happy, I think it's always an addition to it. So it's not 50-50, it's 100% and 100%.
Agreed.
Because you have two whole people.
Right.
And then you can truly, like, enjoy each other.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
You know?
So we've heard all about your journey today, and it's been a pleasure having you.
Thank you. It's been a pleasure being here.
What's one piece of advice you could give someone, since your journey, everyone's journey is their own, mm-hmm. right? Especially in entertainment. So what's one piece of advice you could give someone pursuing the same career?
Work. And continue to keep working, in the sense of you can always create work. One of the things that I think are important is, like, you know, every day there's something you can do towards your craft. Because right now there's somebody else on some film set and they're working. So that's almost like their class.
Yeah.
So even if it's doing voice work, reading scripts, going over scripts, just memorizing scripts, just even meditation, just consistently work. Because I know for me that helped me in some ways, and it still does, because there's still a ton more growth for me. But I'm happy to go against the person who goes to class once a week and pats himself on the back. Because I know I'm daily putting in hours to make sure, you know, so that it's second nature. So I think with anything, you reap what you sow. So you have to put in the work. And there's an old African saying, and it says that the river that's for you won't run past you. And I think, like, if you put in the time and the effort and the work, I feel like it comes back to you.
Yes, I'm over here feeling it. I'm like, yes, love that. And before we get out of here, where can your fans find you online?
I am on, you can find me on Twitter at Gavin Houston. And that's it. I actually don't have an Instagram.
Really?
What? Gavin, everybody goes crazy. I know. I think I'm like, I was the last person to get Facebook. So I think I'm finally going to commit to getting
it. So Snapchat's out of the question. Then.
Snapchat is out. I mean, this is the biggest snap I got. You can snap and talk. That's my Snapchat.
Right. Make sure you guys always use our hashtag BHL next, because we want to see what you're talking about, what you like, what you think. And who are you, sir?
James Ward III. You can find me again at James Ward III across all social platforms.
Check out Gavin and all the amazing cast on the Haves and Have Nots on OWN every Tuesday, 9, 8 Central. I'm Megan Thomas. You can get me at Meg Scoop on all of your social media. We love you guys. We'll see you next week. Bye.
From executives Kevin Undergaro, Dario Kristen, Tiana Hobson, and the entire BHL staff, we would like to thank you for supporting Black Hollywood Live, the first online broadcast network dedicated to African-American entertainment. For questions and comments, contact us. info@blackhollywoodlive.com. Like us on Facebook, tweet us, or Instagram us at BHL Online. And I am the official voice of Black Hollywood Live, Scipio, Instagram at KingXOBay. Thanks for tuning in.
Hollywood redefined.
The views expressed here are those of the host only and do not necessarily reflect the views of BHL or its owners or principals.